Welcome to Betty's Kitchen. Today we're making deep fried green and ripe tomatoes. Usually you just see green tomatoes when they're fried. And I have fried green tomatoes in Betty's Kitchen if you're interested. It's a totally different recipe. It uses cornmeal and it has a batter that the slices are dipped in, and it's fried in just a few tablespoons of oil on top of the stove in a skillet. But we're going to deep fry these, so the coating is going to be quite different, and we're also going to do some red tomatoes to show you what those come out like as well. Tomatoes are plentiful in Kentucky right now. You might notice I have some just sitting out here, and these were given to us by our neighbor across the street because he had too many, and he thought maybe we could use them. And actually we have plenty right now on our tomato vine. We have two vines, but one is major vine and the other one is kind of dying down. But the size of our tomatoes is not very big, not as big as the ones you see from the neighbor. A green tomato is about this size right now on our plants. And I've still left the top on. I'm going to take that off and I'll wash this again. I've washed it once and dried it, but I'll take care of that in just a second. Just wanted to show you what they look like straight off the vine. I went out and got them just a few minutes ago. And then our ripe tomatoes, same plant, but the ripened tomato looks like this. They're not perfect, but they're not bad. We have not put any kind of chemical on them. We've watered them once. So they have not had a lot of care, and maybe that's why they're not big and juicy looking like the ones that Earl from across the street gave us. So I'm taking off these caps from the tomatoes. I'm going to just give these a quick rinse and I'll be back after I get them dried. I've sliced up one of the ripe tomatoes, and you can see I'm using slices that are all about the same. I thought I would just go ahead and wait a minute and let you see the slicing of the green tomato. It's much more firm than the ripe tomato. You need to get this end piece off because it's not going to be good. It's not very juicy, and also it has that place where the stem was. And then also the bottom will take off. And then it looks like about three slices worth. I'm not fixing a whole lot because this is just going to be for Rick and me tonight, and you can do as many as you want as long as you keep replenishing the coating mix and the egg wash and so on and the oil that you need. But we're just doing one green tomato and then two ripe tomatoes. So just cut down through it like that, and I think I have one more slice to go here. And that takes care of our green tomato. That's what you're going to expect to see in a green tomato that you're going to have fried. And there we go. So I have a couple of pieces to throw out there, and the rest of these are good. So we'll start with the green ones, but first let's put together what we're going to dip them into. We're going to start with some flour. This is just like an old cup that I've had forever, and I filled it with flour. It doesn't matter how much, just what you think you need. And that would be about a half cup that I have put in. These are two eggs that I've already beaten, and I would like to season them a little bit, so I'm just going to grind some sea salt in. I think that way maybe you'll crunch down into a little bit of salt occasionally. So I like that better than just doing the fine salt. Same thing with the pepper. I like having an actual taste of pepper now and then. And we'll just swirl that around a little bit. Each slice is going to get dipped in there, so that's where it's going to get its flavor, other than natural flavor. And then next, we need a coating that is going to stick to the flour covered by the egg. And that coating, I haven't showed you this particular coating, but it's very nice and you can use it for many things. You can use it for vegetables of all varieties, and you can also use it for meats. But I like to use it for deep frying, and it has panko breadcrumbs, and I have 1 1/2 cups here. That's quite a lot for what I'm doing, so I don't think I'll put them all in. Again, just use what you need. I'll probably write this up with a certain measurement for you that will work out for a certain number of tomatoes. But you may have loads of tomatoes to do, or you may have just two or three like me. Now I'm going to mix that with cracker crumbs. You can use any kind of cracker crumb that you like. What I have is Ritz cracker crumbs, and I put them in this gallon size Ziploc bag, closed it up, and then I used a dough roller to a rolling pin to go over it again and again until these are very fine. So probably an equal amount of cracker meal or cracker crumbs to go with your panko breadcrumbs. So I'm just going to let that slide out of here. It's imprecise, it doesn't really matter, but I've held on to probably half of it or so. Something like that. And you just need to kind of use your hands there. I don't have a lot of this mixture, so I'm kind of rethinking that I might put just a little more of the panko breadcrumbs and a little more of this. But all in all, I'm keeping them pretty equal. Don't want to run out, because it's kind of a messy thing when you're dipping an egg, whether it's vegetables or meats or what. You're going to get a little messy, so you don't want to run out and have to make all of this again. Okay, I think what we're going to do is start our oil over here and come back and coat some of these. The oil is peanut oil, and we have 1 inch. And I've already heated it some so it wouldn't take so long to come up to the point I need. So I'm going to turn it on, and my back will be to it, but I don't think it's going to reach 350 degrees in the time that it takes me to do a little work here. In fact, I'll just get started on this to show you the procedure and then probably go away and then come back when everything is ready to come together. But I said I would start with the green tomatoes. So here is the slice. You don't add any water or anything. This flour sticks well. There will be enough juice from your green tomato, and you expect it to look something like that. Then you're going to remove that spoon, dip this down into your egg wash, and then into your cracker meal and panko breadcrumbs. See what a nice coating that is? And it's ready to go in hot oil, but I'm going to just place it over here, and I'm very particular about being gentle with it because I don't want to knock all the crumbs off. It's a nice coating, and that's the way it should look. Let's do one of the red ones. So I'm just picking this one up. It's kind of an end piece, but it will be a little easier to keep the flour on because it's a little juicier. Here we go with flour, and then into the egg wash. Get it completely covered, and that kind of makes the flour stick on a little better. And then into your crumb mix. If you don't like to use panko breadcrumbs or cracker crumbs, you don't happen to have them, fine dry breadcrumbs will work perfectly. So there's what our red one looks like. So I'm going to finish these up, have them ready to deep fry, and at the same time I'll keep an eye on the peanut oil. I don't want it to smoke, so I would like to have it at about 350 degrees. And some of you are going to ask, may I use a different oil? Certainly, you can use any vegetable oil that you like. But if you use something like olive oil, it smokes at a low heat, so it's not really that good of a choice. So I'll be back to show you how to fry these. I've got all of my tomato slices ready to go, and this is just something optional. Rick and I like to have a little bit of ground red pepper. So I'm just going to sprinkle that on the tops of these before they go in, and it's not going to be much at all because this is really spicy, really hot. So you should be barely able to see it, but I think I've got them all at least well enough, and that's just optional. You don't have to do that at all. We're ready to come over here. I think this is about 350 degrees, and I have gotten the tongs. So what I'm going to do is to, let's pick one of the green ones first. I'm going to pick that up and just put it in gently, and you should see sizzling like that, and there should be no smoking. So that looks good. I'm gonna do a ripe one right beside it. They kind of take care of themselves. And let's get another green one. Most of you probably would be more interested in the green tomatoes fried than in the ripe tomatoes. But we like to do them both ways. So I'm just gonna show you what they look like. This will float up to the top, and it will either turn itself or I will help it in turning it over with these tongs. And they're getting nice and brown. I'm gonna wait just a second more, and then we'll bring them out onto a tray, a platter, that has a paper towel. This is a double thickness of paper toweling, and that will help to absorb some of the oil. So here we go, and I have turned this off right now, temporarily. And we'll just pause a little bit before we start the next bunch. And I will keep frying until we get them all done. Those are two really nice fried green tomatoes. And then here is the one that was red. Doesn't that look good? I'll do the rest of them and you'll see the whole plate in just a minute. Here are our deep fried green and ripe tomatoes. And I don't know if you can tell which ones are the green. Actually, I put the three green ones right there, so they would be a little more visible. The rest of them, obviously that's red, and all the rest of them are red. Now, you could put them on a platter like this and serve them. Admittedly, this is a very small amount, because it's not for a huge group of people. It's just for us here at home tonight. But when I serve this, I would maybe have a salad plate like this with a little bit of lettuce on it. And I've used lettuce as a background here. You might want spinach leaves or something like that. I think I'm gonna pick one of the red ones because maybe you haven't seen a fried ripe tomato. I'm gonna put it on my salad plate. And then a really nice topping to use, or sauce to use with it, is remoulade sauce. So I made some of that earlier today, just so I would have it for this purpose, but it is in Betty's Kitchen. If you want to look up remoulade sauce, I'll have it written in the description, and you can look it up if you have any problems spelling that. So we'll just take a little bit and put it on the side there, and that makes a lovely dish, and I'll be tasting that for you in just a minute. So here I am at my place setting, and I have a nice glass of iced tea, and I even put the whole pitcher out here today because it's a steamy day outside, and this mint looks so cooling and refreshing. I want to take a bite of this for you. Remember, this is the red one. It should be crunchy on the outside, and there should be sauce ready for you to dip it in. If you don't like this sauce, you can pick among a lot of other sauces that I have in Betty's Kitchen, or just use tartar sauce from the grocery store. That'd be fine. And there's what the piece looks like. It's going to fall apart a little bit, but I'm going to dip it first and then take a bite. Mmm. The crust is the best, but that tomato is warm, and that's wonderful too. I don't know what I like most about it, because the remoulade sauce, and it is a dill pickle remoulade sauce, it adds to the flavor, but it doesn't overpower it in any way. And the tomato is just slightly changed from a sliced tomato. It's warmed up, and it's kind of oozy and runny. And then the outer part is the crust, and it's crunchy and delicious. Hope you like it.